start spending your father's inheritance right now, today. Because that's what we need to have. We need to have. Everything that God wants to do in our midst today, everything that God is wanting to bring into our lives, all the greatness, all of the amazing future of heaven, he wants to bring into our lives today. On earth, as it is in heaven, that's what he wants to do in our midst. And I'd like to talk a bit more about that. I know we've been sharing for a couple of weeks already, but there's so much to talk about in this subject, because on earth, as it is in heaven, is just a big subject. And I want us to try and get a hold of this. But also, when it talks about the kingdom of God, because, you know, the kingdom of God is it's not intuitive, or it's not something that we can easily grasp. And we need to actually keep on referring to it, because, you know, I believe that God wants us to build a culture of the supernatural, not just to see occasional sporadic things happen. You know, we often have altar calls, people come to the front, we pray for people, you probably pray for your people at home or wherever it might be. We pray and sometimes we see miracles. I don't think God really wants us to sometimes see miracles. I think he wants us to live in an atmosphere, an environment of the supernatural, and we cultivate a culture of the supernatural, that every day of our life, that's really what we're seeing happen. Because we're walking, you know, Catherine's been sharing about, you know, walking in, breathing out different air, just breathing something from God and walking and living in that. You know, to build a culture of something, you have to be consistent. It's not enough to be spasmodic or do something in little spurts, fits and starts. You've got to be consistent to build a culture of something. For example, you can't just say to yourself, well, you know, I can be thankful today. Today, I'm going to be thankful. We say that, don't we? Today, I'm going to be thankful. Friends, it's not good enough. You can't be thankful today. What about tomorrow? What about next week and next year? We should develop a culture of thankfulness. What about forgiveness? We could say, well, I think, yeah, I can forgive that person. Today, I'm going to forgive that person. It's not enough. We've got to say to ourselves, I am going to build into my life a principle and a process and a culture of forgiveness. That's what I do. I forgive people. Jesus encouraged us to do that. So building a culture of the supernatural. And so coming back to heaven on earth, what does heaven on earth really look like for us today? I want to read a couple of scriptures to you as we get into this. The first one in Luke chapter 17, it goes like this. Jesus, when he was grilled by the Pharisees on when the kingdom of God would come, he answered, "The kingdom of God doesn't come by counting the days on the calendar." In other words, it's not a future event, okay? "Nor when someone says, 'Look here,' or 'There it is.' And why? Because God's kingdom is already among you." Now, my first point this morning is to simply say that the kingdom of God is not a future event. It's here and now. It's right here with us. The kingdom of God is right here where we are today. This is the kingdom of God. So important that we get a hold of that. It's not future. It's not out there somewhere. You know, we watch, you know, sci-fi movies and say everything's out there. It's not out there. It's here. God, Jesus wanted to make that really clear. The kingdom of God is here among you right now. And there's another scripture in Romans 8 that says this: "The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children." Now, we're talking about something here and now, what God has doing and has done in your life. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. Now, the point that I want to make this morning, friends, is that you have an inheritance in God. You are an heir of Christ. The Bible is very clear. If we are God's children, we are heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. Now, an heir is someone who has an inheritance. So we have an inheritance in God, and that is to be conformed to the image of his Son. The Bible says also in Romans 8, it says, "God knew his people in advance, and he chose them to become like his Son." So God is in the process of making us more and more like Jesus every day as we submit to his direction and to his, you know, leading in our lives. Is that happening for you? Are you becoming more and more like Jesus every day? I can see some smiles and a few perplexed looks. And, you know, that's our inheritance, to be conformed to the image of his son. Now, it's easy for us to think when we talk about inheritance that an inheritance is a future thing that you will in the future inherit. But I want us to understand, and the Bible is quite clear about this, that our inheritance in God is not just future, it's also here and now. But you see, we have the risk that we could look at heaven as just a future thing, or our inheritance as being something down there in the future, and actually miss all the riches of heaven that he has for us right now. Because you see, friends, it's important we understand today that there are some things that God wants to do in your life and is doing in your life that only have relevance right here and now. For example, the anointing of God upon you to heal the sick and his power to come in your life, to bring deliverance and in people's lives. Do you know what? That will be of no value in heaven because there is no sickness there. There is no one's going to be affected by an evil spirit in heaven. No one has sickness. There is no pain, no sorrow, no crying, no tears. The anointing that God brings upon your life to heal and set people free only has relevance here and now. So this part of our inheritance has to be taken hold of now. And this morning, what I'd like to do is help you to spend your inheritance. Start spending your inheritance right now. Okay. How many of you have seen on the back of some camper van, we are spending our children's inheritance, right? Have you seen that? Well, I want to encourage you and help you to start spending your father's inheritance right now, today. Because that's what we need to have. We need to be doing about the kingdom of God. What is it about the kingdom of God that we need to take a hold of today? Number one, it's the second point really, it's not instantaneous. It's a process because God is doing something in your life. That's a process. Let's look at John chapter 1:12. You know the scripture. It says, as many as received Jesus into their heart, he gave them the right or the authority to become a child of God. Now, that word become is quite fascinating when you look at the original language. It's a word that talks about transformation, but it's also talking about a process. It means to come into being, and it implies motion, movement, or growth. It really means to emerge. That word where God says, I'm giving you the authority to become a child of God, it means to emerge as a child of God. Now, that means it's a process. It's not happening instantaneously. Now, there's a part of it that is instantaneous. I know that when you invite Jesus into your life, something happens on the inside. A little flickering candle starts to burn on the inside of you. And you know all of a sudden something's happened. Something's different. I've got Jesus on the inside of my life. And it's wonderful. But he's not finished. It's not all there is. He's got a lot more for you. He wants to change every part of your life. And I know over the past couple of weeks, Paul shared about it last week. And I think the week before I was talking about it. God is progressively doing things in our life and changing and bringing us more into the image of Jesus. And so we can see more and more of his power at work in us. The next point is that the kingdom of God is not a physical place. It's a spiritual thing, but it affects the physical areas around our life. And when Jesus said, let your kingdom come, that we should pray to God, Lord, let your kingdom come, he wasn't talking about a physical location. Now, I have to say this because in the world today, there are a number of, we call them monarchies, you know, like the kingdom of Thailand, there's the kingdom of Norway, there's lots of other kingdoms there are. He's not talking about a location. He's talking about the rule and the rulership and the reign of God in our lives. I mentioned before that passage in 1 Chronicles 29 where David is bringing the people together for one last celebration before he comes to the end of his life. And, you know, he prepared this massive store of wealth. But it says at the end of that passage in 1 Chronicles, he says, yours, O God, as part of David's prayer and David's celebration to God, he says, yours, O God, is the kingdom. We actually used to sing this song years and years ago. Yours, O Lord, is the kingdom. All the power on earth and heaven and earth belongs to you. We used to sing that. Yours is the kingdom. When David wrote Psalm 145, he said these words, your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom. Now that word there is an important word in the original language. It refers to reign and rulership, and only a second meaning is the area or the realm or the location over which the king ruled. It's not talking about your kingdom, meaning the nation of Israel or some other place. It's not talking about a place. It's talking about a rulership and a reign. And so when we say, God, let your kingdom come, we're not saying, you know, come and take over the government of Australia or the government of Queensland. Not talking about that. We're saying, Lord, we have your rulership in our hearts. We have the reign of God in our lives, and we want that more and more to come. We want to surrender more and more to his rulership in our life so that it will come. It's a spiritual rulership and a spiritual kingdom, but it affects everything about our lives in a physical and a practical sense. The next thing about it, about the kingdom of God, is it's not a fantasy, it's real. The kingdom of God is very real. Now, when we talk about spiritual things, sometimes we have the idea that it's about something that's, when it's out there, it's a bit of a fantasy, you know. This is not. And I want us to read this passage from Matthew 18. Jesus spoke these words, and he said this to his disciples. I want you to take this most seriously. A yes on earth is yes on heaven. Now, before I go on, the context of this passage is important, because he's talking about people where there's a breach of relationship and that gets restored. The relationship is restored. Read it in this context. A yes on earth, in other words, people agreeing together on earth is yes in heaven. A no on earth is no in heaven. What you say to one another is eternal. I mean this. I think Jesus is getting a little bit serious here. He's saying to his followers, you need to get this. This is really important. I mean this. When two of you get together on anything at all on earth and make a prayer of it, my Father in heaven goes into action. And when two of you are together because of me, you can be sure I'll be there. So Jesus is saying, that's why we do small groups, you know. We like to get people together, you know, to pray and encourage one another. Because when you get together with other people, what happens? Jesus said, I'm going to be there. My Spirit is there among you. And things, that's where things happen. That's where miracles happen. That's not, it's not just about fellowship. This is about the power of God. This is about people being raised up. This is about good things happening. So we believe in small groups. But the reason I want to read that passage is because this is real. When we get together, we agree together, and we speak it, we pray together, we pray it. When we agree a yes on earth, it's yes in heaven. And Jesus says, something's going to happen. My Father goes into action when you do this. Agreement is a powerful thing. We should never underestimate the power of people being in agreement on earth, right here. People being in agreement. And if that's hard for you, maybe you already know everything there is to know about life, and it's just hard to agree with someone else who might disagree with you. You need to change it. Just let God do something in your heart and humble your heart and say, yep, okay, I was wrong. It's possible. It's possible to say that. Does anyone have trouble saying that? No one here. Maybe I'm the only one who has trouble saying that. But okay, so, and in John the Baptist, this amazing passage in Matthew 11. So, John, it says, meanwhile, had been locked up in prison. And when he got wind of what Jesus was baptizing a lot of, you know, people. Or he came to be baptized and he was starting his ministry. And it says that he sent his own disciples to ask, are you the one we've been expecting or are we still waiting? And Jesus told them, go back and tell John what's going on. In other words, give John a report. It's like a report card. Go back to John and tell him exactly what's happening. The blind see, the lame walk, lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, the wretched of the earth learn that God is on their side. Is that what you're expecting? You know, because it may have been that John, when he was really trying to figure out what was happening here, maybe he was losing the plot a little bit. I'm not sure. But it's likely that he was looking for some other kind of kingdom. I don't know. But this is the kingdom of God. What Jesus is saying is, this is the work of the kingdom. This is what you should be expecting. blind eyes open, deaf ears open, lame people walking, lepers being cleansed, the dead being raised, people hearing the good news about Jesus. These are the things, this is the work of the kingdom. This is what you should be expecting, and it's what we should be expecting today too, friends. It's exactly what we should be seeing and say. And I want to say right here, friends, that God is doing not only doing some of these things in our life, but I really believe that he's got great plans for you and also for this church. He wants to do some of these things. I'll say it right now that as I was praying this week, I really felt God impressed on me that we will see miracles happen here, right here. Now, we've already seen numbers of them, but I'm talking about amazing miracles. I was reading this morning, and it says in the Apostle Paul, it says that through Paul's hand, special miracles or unusual miracles or miracles that were out of the ordinary happened through Paul. And I believe God wants to do that. Not only that, there's enough people here in this congregation that already believe in that, that believe, have got faith for that, that there'll be an atmosphere. When the time comes, there'll be an atmosphere. Now, I'm asking you this morning, can you believe with me to see people get out of wheelchairs? Now, see, there are a number of people that believe, that can believe for that. You know, to see supernatural things or amazing things or unusual miracles happen. We can see that. And not only that, I believe God put in my heart, we will see that. We will see that this week. You know, in Acts chapter 10, verse 38, there's this great passage. It says, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth, who went around doing good and healing all who were oppressed of the devil because God was with him. And one of the amazing things about that is that it shows that Jesus performed all of his miracles, not just because he was God, but because he was an anointed man. It says how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth, who went about doing good and doing these amazing things because God was with him. You see, that shows us that he can use you, that you can be anointed by God, that you can do the same things that Jesus did. I mean, also he said in the Gospels, it says the words of Jesus, he said that the same things that I do and greater things will you do because I go to my Father. What he meant was because I'm sending the Holy Spirit, because you will have the power of the Holy Spirit in your life. You will be able to do the same things, the same miracles of Jesus, and even greater, greater in extent, I believe, he's talking about. And so that's our mandate, to do these things that are the works of the kingdom. The last point is, it's not just for others, it's for me. The kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, is not just about the person sitting next to you or some other person who might have a real anointing on their life, so to speak. It's for you. It's for every one of us in this room right now. You know, when we talk about heaven, we talk about heaven on earth and, Lord, let your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. You know, we're talking about heaven, and sometimes you could think, well, it's only just for old people. Because, you know, well, give them a few years and that's where they'll be going. So, you know, maybe we should let them talk about it. But, you know, I'm 20 years old or I'm 10 years old. I don't need to worry too much. I want to tell you, if you are 10 or 20 years old, you should be thinking about this and praying about this exactly the same. Because it's not about future, it's about now. I believe that the 10 or 20-year-old really should be at the forefront of bringing God's kingdom to earth right here, right now. I really believe that. If you're 10 years old, take this to heart right now, because I believe you can see God's power at work in your life. You can see significant miracles in your life. The last thing I want to share about is just how does this happen? You know, I think when we get a hold of the power that's in your own story, every one of us here has got a story of some kind. We've all got a different story, a different testimony. It's when you start to share those stories, that's when something powerful begins to happen. Faith begins to rise in other people. You know, when you share your story, maybe God has done something. Let me just ask, you know, who's got a story here? Now, people are great. That's great. I know some of you probably might be a bit cautious because you're thinking, he's going to ask me to come up the front and share my story, right? Well, guess what? I might do that. I took a mental note of all those people raised their hands. But, you know what? When you share what God did in your life, a couple of things happen. Number one, you might not think you're a prophet, but you can be prophesying over that person's life. This happened to me, it can happen to you. It can be a prophetic statement. The Bible actually says that the essence of prophecy is to bring a witness for Jesus. A clear witness for Jesus. It's what prophecy is about. You can be prophesying healing in that person's life. The second thing is, when you share what happened in your life, you can be a catalyst to generate and create faith in that person's heart, that they can reach out and believe, well, maybe that can happen for me as well. That happened for you, maybe it can happen for me as well. God will use your story to trigger faith in someone else. I want to share with you a story, and I've mentioned this before, this story. It's from Bill Johnson. He told this story, but in his church, about a three-year-old boy who had severe club feet. You know, his feet were turned inwards, and he couldn't stand flat on the ground. It was quite severe. And they prayed for him in a meeting, and he was amazingly healed, and it was just an incredible thing. And he put his, for the first time, put his feet flat on the ground. It was just incredible. And a little while after that, a couple of their Bible college students said one day, well, why don't we go down to the shopping center and find someone to pray for, which is quite normal for them, it's a very normal thing to do. So they went down to the shopping center, and they saw this old lady who was sort of hobbling along with a walking stick, and she didn't look too good. And they said, well, she'd be a good candidate for us to pray for. So they went up to her, and they said, look, can we pray for you? And she flatly refused it. No, not interested. They began to tell the story about the boy a few days earlier that they'd seen healed who had club feet. And they said, okay, you can pray for me. They began to pray for her, and they discovered that she had a tumor on her knee. And as they prayed, the tumor disappeared. And she took the leg brace, she just took it off. You know? But while they were praying, one of the students had a word of knowledge that she also had another tumor on her back, and she hadn't mentioned anything about it. And so they said, can we pray? As they prayed, it also disappeared. It also vanished, it just disappeared. And so what happened is this old lady's, her family came out of the store where they were, and they found her there, and they walked out of the store with her carrying her leg brace, you know, and carrying her walking stick. And it was just an amazing, amazing story. Anyway, a couple of weeks later, Bill Johnson was sharing this in a meeting again, and there was a lady there whose daughter, she dropped her daughter off, I think about a two-year-old daughter, had dropped her off into their kids' church program, the creche, actually. And as this lady was in the meeting just hearing this testimony, hearing the story, she said to herself, I'll take that for my daughter, because her daughter also had malformed feet. Had a problem with her feet. And she said, I will take that for my daughter, as Bill Johnson was sharing that testimony. At the end of the meeting, she went into the creche to pick up her daughter, and her daughter's feet were perfectly normal, and no one had prayed for her. It was an amazing story, because what happened is her faith was ignited by that testimony, by that story. And your story can do something amazing in the lives of other people. So I want to encourage you, don't hold back, but share what Jesus has done in your life, because it's going to have a snowballing or a compounding effect in the lives of other people. And you don't know how far that might go, how far that could go, and how many people could really be touched and really blessed by that. I'm going to ask our creative team to come back right now, and maybe we can sing that song. I'm going to see a victory, because I believe God wants to do amazing things in our lives. And maybe you're here this morning and you're saying, well, I've got a story, but I've never actually shared it before. And maybe he's just wanted to put something in your heart of faith today to be able to share that story today. As we start to sing this song, why don't you reach out to God and say, you know, Jesus, give me the capacity and the courage that I need to share my story. Maybe you feel that your story is only half written today, and there's so much more that God wants to do in your life. And I want to give you an opportunity. We'd love to pray with you, actually, today and see God's power at work in your life today. Because I really believe that God wants to touch some people's hearts this morning and touch your life. Maybe you're here and you've always wondered, you know, if God was real or if this whole thing about God was just maybe a fantasy. And this morning something's happened and you're sensing, yeah, I'm starting to understand this is real. This is real for me. And you know that's called the Holy Spirit just touching your heart, just tapping you on the shoulder and saying, yeah, that's for me. That's you right now. I wonder, can we all stop?